Hey there, this is Perch, and this is the first of what will probably be many different sessions on villains. And I have this theory that I've given before that villains, the strength of the comic is really based on the strength of the villain. And what I mean by that is you can have a great hero and you can have a great team and you can have, you know, good character dynamics and really rich, exciting mythology. But if the villains, and by villains, I really mean the conflict. If the conflict is weak, then at the end of the day, you know, sales will suffer, interest will suffer, attachment will suffer, because people see heroism through a lens of overcoming conflict. And, you know, lots of, you can argue, and I have argued that that's not how people should see heroism, and that's not what makes a hero, and the quiet moments are as valuable as the loud moments. And sure, all those things are true. Chris Claremont would do plenty of issues where the X-Men would be playing baseball and having downtime, and it was used as a way to, you know, give some deeper meaning to the characters, to show them they're more dimensional than just constantly fighting bad guys. But he also made really big threats. He made the villains larger than life. You know, he made it so that every time the X-Men stepped into a battle with a major villain, there was a question of could they endure? They were outmatched. They were outthought, outmaneuvered. The villains were in control. So what can they do? How can they overcome? That's the conflict that gets set up. And one consequence of this current era of comics, this modern era of comics, is that villainy has been downplayed a lot. And a lot of it has to do with this kind of notion that started around, you know, you saw a bit of it in the late 90s, but really around the early 2000s, where there's a desire to give villains depth, just like the heroes. And there's nothing wrong with that. In fact, it's a great idea. I think when you give nuance to villains, it can make them more threatening and definitely adds to the story and the overall dynamic. But humanizing villains also can have a negative side effect. And one of those was not apparently obvious. So when the Marvel line did the Dark Reign story that came right after Secret Invasion, and basically the concept was that Norman Osborn, the Green Goblin, got the kill shot on the Skrull Queen and thereby elevated, you know, was able to use that moment to elevate himself into a hero in the eyes of the government and the people. And he immediately began manipulating things and brought in his villain buddies, and you had an era, and in hindsight, if you go back and read those issues, and we will do some reviews of them, sort of a silly era in a lot of respects. But the setup was that this is what happens when villains take over. And I think we're about to see kind of a different spin of that with DC's Year of the Villain, which is kicking off here later this year. And it's been part of Snyder's run with Justice League, which we'll talk about that in a minute too. But the consequence of what happened with Dark Reign is Brian Michael Bendis, who was heading Dark Avengers in a lot of these books, humanized the villains. And unfortunately, that also meant kind of making them silly in certain aspects, or giving them various, you know, neurotic behavior, or kind of that Seinfeld, that Joss Whedon type dialogue that, you know, in small doses is charming for heroes. In small doses for villains, it kind of has the effect of weakening the threat. And that's what happened. The threat felt weaker. The threat felt, it's hard to get excited when Ultron is quipping. And when villains are like, oh, look at the old robot over here. I mean, when you have that kind of banter, yes, it's probably, you know, to some extent more realistic, maybe. I mean, it's hard to wrap your head around that if you have a, you know, super powerful killing AI machine that's going to murder all humanity. Would the humans be standing around kind of joking at it? Hard to say. Probably not. But it had an interest. It was popular at the time, and I think people were, it was something new to see the villains handled in this way, so that was kind of cool. But it weakened the overall villains. It weakened the threat. And I'm not putting all the blame on Bendis. It was a style that everybody was using at the time. They were using these kind of, you know, wacky, quippy villains. And So time marches on, and what you've seen is certainly at Marvel, the villains are, it's hard to take them seriously, and the events and the threats are hard to take seriously. You also have the challenge of events tend to come up, they're going to change the world, and people get murdered, and then, you know, stuff gets put back in the box. You have, you know, the Red Skull's daughter, Sin, in Fear Itself, kind of get elevated to a god and murder Bucky mostly, and just go on to just destroy tons and tons of people. And then here we are, you know, 10 years later, and she's in Old Man Logan, and she's kind of walking around yucking it up with Crossbones, and she's kind of an incompetent doof. And so it's just, it's hard, you know, villains, when villains are threatening, then the heroes rise to the occasion with those villains. And it's just, once you start to erode that, it takes a lot of effort to get the villain back up there. So I'll draw a parallel right now to what's going on in Justice League with Scott Snyder. And Snyder is somebody who I sells very well in the store. And he's an interesting character because people who come in and put money on the counter and buy books like Snyder. I mean, there's not complaints. Tom King is sort of, it's a very strong selling book, but there's definitely some hit and miss aspects to him. There's some people who come in and kind of grumble about things he's done with some of the characters. But Snyder is typically, you know, all love with one exception. And that exception is that his concepts are really kind of, I don't want to say off the wall, just he goes big in his concepts. And you especially see that with Justice League. He goes really, really big. And kind of like Morrison, it's a very similar complaint that I hear from time to time about Morrison. People don't always know what the hell is going on. It's like we're getting 8,000 concepts thrown in our face. And it, you know, it's like, hey, could you guys put out a book that just kind of, for lack of a better word, dumbs it down a little bit? Just walk me through this just a little bit, because I'm having trouble keeping up with all the crazy stuff that's going on. And so that's something you hear in a store. Online, you know, there's a whole social component to it, and there's a, you know, he denounced Comicsgate, therefore, you know, he's an awful creator, and so on. But again, I think, not to get into the social world versus the store world, you know, Snyder's he's a solid bet. Again, if you're a comic store retailer and you're trying to say, you know, what money am I going to put out to get money in the store? You know, Snyder is one of those ones that, you know, you buy Snyder's books, you put them in the store, they sell. Can't get better than that. But I think what you are seeing with Snyder, and it's part of You're the Villain, there's a couple different, you know, Tom King is bringing in Bane, and there's a few other storylines kind of all threading in to You're the Villain. But Bendis is bringing in Leviathan and some of the storylines he's got with Superman. But to me, the start of it and the real initiation, or as at least as it looks on the outside, is that with Justice League, Snyder brought back the Legion of Doom. He brought back the concept of we are villains who are trying to do evil things for evil reasons, and we are evil, and there's no kind of bones about that, and that they are going to murder and steal, and they're going to be villains. And even though you see some banter between the villains, it's not this kind of jokey, ha ha ha, you know, let's make fun of each other. It's more along the lines of grumbling, kind of what you'd expect out of villains, of kind of Luthor and Brainiac kind of trying to outmaneuver each other. And, you know, got a little Thundercats in there. You know, Black Manta and some of these other characters who may be a little bit outmatched by some of these bigger villains, but they're trying to stand their own. And so I think he's bringing a focus back to villains, and that's a big positive thing. And it's something that hopefully the other writers, you know, will hold on to. That's why I'm very optimistic about You're the Villain. I think this is probably the one storyline or marketing effort that I see has the potential to, you know, really turn things for DC in a positive direction, because if they really elevate very strong villains, very big threats, make it serious, make the heroes have to struggle to overcome, readers buy into that, and they buy into it in a really consistent way. They come in month after month, and they buy the books and they're invested. It's not a casual purchase. And so I think that's really positive. I think that's a little bit what you saw with Metal, where Metal was a very strong selling series. It did great. But unlike most events these days, the Metal tie-ins sold as well. And they were backgrounds into these villains, but it really pushed on the villainy. It wasn't, some were more tragic than others. Some were more straight up, kind of ruination of Bruce Wayne and in these different alternate worlds, how Batman is corrupted. They all took the approach of, this is a serious threat. We're going to show you a story about this. And it did well. And I think, and that's the kind of the confusing part to me, honestly, is there's decades of sales data that proves that when you have big time villains, serious threat, how can the heroes overcome? You take it all very, very seriously. It sells. It always sells. And there's equal sales evidence to prove that when you make it too jokey, and when you downplay the threat, and you kind of, you just mess around with it, doesn't sell as well. Every time. I mean, you can go down the list. I think a lot of folks who are writing comics today, I think they're trying to capture the sales and spirit of things like Scott Pilgrim, which is fine. That sold well too, but they forget kind of the lesson that, make a really major villain and you will have a major hero, and you'll have a good selling book, and you'll have something worth remembering. Anyway, that's my take on it. I don't know. What do you guys think? Villains, do they matter? Am I making too big a deal out of it? Maybe, it doesn't really matter. And, it's really all about the hero. So what's your take? So let me know in the comments. Follow me. Set the bell for notification. Talk to me on Twitter. Whatever you happen to do, thanks for listening.